just what fortune we have to have a festival of this caliber in the state. It's really great. And in part because they bring together such wonderful people. We have on the panel a mix of filmmakers whose films are in the festival, as well as a couple of local filmmakers whose work absolutely ties in with our theme, which is indie filmmaking and social change, the global challenge. And we truly have an international panel here. To my immediate right is Nick Brandestini, who is here from Zurich. Then we have Craig Saddlemeyer from Lewiston. We have Hussein Karabey from Izmir and Istanbul, Turkey. Alban Maino from France and Portland. And Klaus Drexel, who is here from, in a way, representing France and Germany, but we'll say France for now.
That's right.
Okay. all of them are very much involved in work that has as its heart an intent or a purpose to inspire people towards change, to take action, to be involved, to be engaged. But all of them are working in quite different and very interesting ways. So hopefully the panel will be able to touch upon all of these facets. I'd just like to introduce Nick first to say that his film, Children of the Arctic, is here in the festival showing this afternoon. It's a film about youth, youth in a way who we might consider at risk, but there's a very interesting and strong community tradition behind them. See the film. You'll get to see a bit of a clip here. This film has actually had quite a bit of interesting festival exposure here in the U.S. It's already been at Cinequest and at Santa Barbara and Big Sky, which are all important film festivals. Nick's previous film, Darwin, about a small town in California, couldn't even call it a town, really. A little bump in the road. That film was shortlisted for an Oscar. It got great reviews in the New York Times and the LA Times. I think that there's definitely a strong connection for you with the US, and we might want to explore that a little bit. But his film, being that it focuses on youth, has a component in its funding that leads to outreach and connection with a youth audience. So we'll get into that a bit. Craig Saddlemeyer, based in Lewiston, has been working as a community activist. Weren't you also on the city council?
Mm-hmm.
Are you still on the city council?
No.
Okay. Enough of the local politics. You want to get back in the trenches. Craig has been making films about everything from housing cooperatives to extended families, young people and their perceptions of where they live. Your work has been shown in a lot of different places across the country, but you're very much about the process and the engagement of your protagonists in the making of the film, which ultimately becomes a piece of the community outreach itself. So we're really interested to hear more about that. Hussein is making films about his own heritage as a Kurdish representative of the arts community. And interestingly, although his films in some ways are almost censored by the Turkish government in the way that what I mean is he gets no funding assistance from them, and yet the films have got tremendous impact both within Turkey and without, and has developed strong relationships with co-producing partners in Germany and France, and has been able to bring these films back to Turkey and do all sorts of community screenings and really inspire a lot of pride in the community and change perceptions about the non-Kurdish members of the Turkish population, which is important too. Alban, based in Portland, has had a history of filmmaking over 25 years, making documentaries of all kinds, but he has a very special initiative here in Maine, which is called Memory Lane TV, the purpose of which is programming that is aimed at Alzheimer's and dementia patients and their caregivers. And he has won a social innovation award at a very important conference that he can tell us about, has gotten a lot of attention around the country for developing this very unique program that uses visual and auditory and even in some cases olfactory stimulation to provide both comfort and stimulation in challenging circumstances. Klaus has made both fiction and documentary films. His latest film is about the homeless in Paris, shot in a very elegiac, gorgeous way, very striking, the approach to this film. And he has used the film in some interesting ways to inform government and care agencies and charities and homeless populations in a sense about themselves, and bringing a kind of dignity and illumination to a world that we just don't see in that way, in that intimate way, quite so often. And again, I think in a way that's similar with Nick, coming from a European background of funding and exposure, there are some sharp contrasts between what can be done here and what is done in the rest of the world. So what I'd like to do is for each of you to share with us a clip and talk a little bit about what you've been doing to get the film out in the world, and a little bit about your process, if you could. So Nick, let's start with you. Mike, we have Children of the Arctic, which I think is just appearing in the file as COTC.
Could you wait 1 second? I just want to explain what we're about to see. First is a short clip. It's a teaser. It's like a minute long. It doesn't tell you much about what the film is about, but it gives more like the mood and the tone of the film, which is music. There's no talk except for the native. There's a guy, you don't even see who it is, but you can hear a voice, somebody speaking in the native language up in Barrow, Alaska. And the second clip, which is 2 minutes, shows some of the whaling activities that they do up there, and it's like the heart of their culture.
Clearly defined, each crew knows how they're going to cut up their whale. The captain will go make first cut, or he'll go show where first cut is going to be made. They'll start with the tufsi, then they'll do the odi, they'll do the main ningek, the sakik, you know, they'll do the talirof, the arm, and then they'll do the etiruk, the back flipper, and they also get the baleen, they'll get the tongue. We use every part of the whale, and you know, down to the 20 gallons of blood that we harvest for the fermented whale meat, you know, we use everything.
Hi!
Yeah.
Watch out, Loki.
Breakfast. Was the voiceover of the whale cutting scene, was that one of your protagonists?
Yes, that was one of the five main protagonists, indeed, yes.
So all the protagonists are all quite different. I mean, some of them see themselves remaining in this community and others are looking much further afield. Talk a little bit about what it was like sharing the film with them when it was finished and what the sort of reactions are when other young people see this film.
Mm-hmm. Like you say, I mean, it ranges. On paper, we did this thing, who of the five characters is most in the traditional world that is, you know, or in the culture that's been going on for thousands of years, and who is more on the Western side or the American or European side. And they're all on this spectrum. And one girl, she's over here because she has a white father from Arizona and a native mother from a small village. And so she's, you know, they're all kind of trying to find where they fit in because they have this interesting background, because the place is, of course, it's part of the US, but it's still, a lot of people don't even know anything about it. Even the people in Alaska itself, in Anchorage and the Big, they don't know anything about how the lifestyle is up there. And they were very happy to share. I mean, they have all seen the film, and I invited them to the Zurich Film Festival. They were very excited to be there, and they were very happy with the film, because they were proud or were happy that there was a chance to show the world their way of life. Because, like I said, almost nobody knows anything about it, and the reaction has been also from the audience very positive. The most critical thing is, as I imagined, is of course the butchering of the whale, which, even though I think it's well explained in the film, that this really, they use every part, you just heard it here too, but still, this is something that some audience members have a little bit of a hard time, and I did not intend to make it shocking, I just wanted to show this is very important to them, and they want to keep this going as long as they can, and it's under, their lifestyle is a bit, under threat sounds a bit negative, but it kind of is, and they want to show the world at least how they still hold on to this and want to keep it going.
So you have funding from two entities, among others, that are in a sense oriented towards community outreach. One of them is called Education 21.
Yes.
And the other one is Film for One World. So how do those two organizations, how are they involved with getting the film out into the community? What role do they take?
Yes, this actually that's the same one. It's a sub
okay.
organization. But Education 21 is an organization that supports a Swiss-based, but it's also international, that supports film that are intended for young people and that have an educational value in one way or another, and they you have to submit, and then they grant the film, some of the films that they deem support worthy, they get a grant, and then they make sure that these films afterwards are also distributed through their network, and they, you know, show it at other institutions, schools, things like that. And we also had a US-based organization, the International Documentary Association. They have a grant called the Perry Lorenz Grant, and there it's a similar thing. And they also publicize the films that they support. It's like five films per year that they get behind, not only financially, but also just through their publicity. They get noted by, you know, different, like also festivals or
right.
schools or things like that.
So have you, it's quite common that you make a feature-length documentary, but that's great for film festivals. Then what do you do in terms of schools and libraries, universities, where a different length is preferred? Typically, an hour is going to work better in a classroom setting, or sometimes even shorter. So do you already have a one-hour version, or is that something you're under pressure to create?
I don't have a one-hour version yet, but I would be open to doing it. And I'm also, that you mentioned the educational market in the US. This is something I think the film has some potential, and this is what I'm working on at this moment. Because the film started this year in the US, it's not that old, so I'm still hoping to get it out there to more, not only festivals, but also into schools where they can teach about, I don't know, different cultures that would fit into that thing. Was there another question, though? I think I forgot to answer one of those.
No, I think you okay. I think you addressed that. I'm also just interested in terms of when you're out in the world with the film, to what extent are young people finding the film, or is it an adult audience that's coming to it? I mean, one of the issues around festivals, of course, is that, you know, marketing to a younger audience. Some festivals make a point of being out in the schools. Hot Docs, for example, up in Toronto, has a very big high school program. I think MIF has some connection with schools, right, Shannon? You're developing a kind of youth-oriented program. It's something all of us as festival directors, we want to make more of that, but it's not as easily done as one might think.
At every single, now that you mentioned this, at every single festival, I was asked if I would be willing to show the film separate times for schools. And I did not, I mean, I knew that the film was about young people, of course, and that it's interesting to them, but it wasn't aimed necessarily at the young audience. It's broader audience. But then the reaction was such that they wanted to show it specifically to schools. And there was one school in Salem, Massachusetts. There's a Salem Film Festival. And there were like different ages. It was like a school for specially bright children, and they were like 10-year-olds. And at first I thought, oof, because they were coming to the screening the day before, and there were, you know, these scenes in the film, and there's some more, and I was a bit worried, but they all completely got it. And I was very, very happy that even the really young kids seemed to get something out of this film.
When we kind of go through, I'd like to come back and talk a little bit about material on YouTube and how to make things available to a younger audience, how to connect, mm-hmm. talk a bit about websites as well. But let's go on to Craig and learn a little bit about your what you refer to as your practice and process, because I feel as though it's something very distinctive, and your commitment to that is distinctive as well. And you're going to share with us a clip from a film that's not your most recent work, but you felt would be particularly relevant here. So tell us why the film Neighbor by Neighbor and a bit about how it came about.
Yep. So the simple term I would use to describe my practice is community-based cinema. And the clip you're going to see is a trailer for a documentary I made in 2009. It began in 2004 and was completed in 2009, so it'll be in standard definition, a nice throwback to the old days of 4x3 480i, and that's all right. And I chose this because I think the process of doing this documentary was a huge transformational shift for me in terms of how I thought about the medium of motion picture and its potential for social change, not just as something that delivers evidence to a general audience about an issue somewhere else in the world, but as something that, through the process of making, actually has the potential to bring about social change, just in the act of doing it itself. And I'll talk more about that. But it was through this process that I really sort of learned that from the group of people that I was working with in making this documentary.
In the beginning, it was very rough because the city felt like we were attacking them, and you know, we felt like we were attacked, you know.
They simply told us what they had decided behind closed doors. The residents were supposed to just take it and like it.
That's when it sort of like hit the fan for us.
And it was tense, would be a good word.
In June of 2004, in the city where I was going to college, a group of downtown residents organized themselves to resist the development of a road that was proposed to, among other things, displace 850 low-income people from their homes. Through a friend, I was invited to videotape their efforts to organize the community around this issue. It was the first time I had stepped foot into the community surrounding my school, and it was an event that transformed my life. 4.5 years later, I am living in this neighborhood, and have finally put together a documentary about these incredible people who gave me my real education about issues of poverty, political power, and community organizing. This preview has been about me, but the movie is all about them.
Just find it so moving. And I think what really is so impactful is that there's tremendous stylishness to it. And that, in a way, kind of defies certain people's expectations. So talk to us about that. Yeah, I mean, you know, you've made some visual choices and some overlay choices in terms of graphics and editing and things like this that are very contemporary feeling and you know, kind of souped up, I would say.
Okay. Well, I guess I'll start by trying to really briefly just sort of summarize my evolution, which was, I mean, when I got into video production, I was like 11 years old, and I wanted to make action movies. Like, I just wanted to recreate like what I saw on the screen. And I think my evolution as a maker has been, you know, becoming more educated, doing a lot of self-exploration, learning more about the world and power and oppression, and a way that's played out in media, the way it's played out in the content of media, and the way it's played out in the ownership and the production of a lot of mainstream media. And so my process has sort of been trying to deprogram that and figure out my position relative to those forces. So first, I was just making fictional action movies and sort of recreating all the bad stuff that I saw on the screen that I thought made me a cool guy if I just like did it and, you know, did it again and showed it to my friends. And then in college, it was my senior year when this thing happened, and I had friends that were involved in the community already, and the group was looking for someone who was willing to volunteer their time to document. There was no expectation that we were going to make a feature-length documentary or that it would really culminate in anything like that. That what they needed was someone to do at least just a basic record of public officials who were making statements that weren't, you know, and not living up to them. So they wanted that, and they also wanted to make just their own really quick sort of responses to what the city was saying about the downtown neighborhood, why it deserved to be destroyed, and all of that, and get it out on public access. And the internet too, but at that time it wasn't as prevalent for streaming video. So, you know, just get it out on the public access or host our own little community showings, and also give the group a chance to sort of watch these public meetings and reflect on what was happening. So video was this really responsive tool in the social change work that the group was doing. I was just there with the privilege to help support them. Meanwhile, I was learning about poverty, about political power, and how you organize to make change happen. But the tools I was bringing to it was someone who had been, again, since I was 11 years old, just sort of crafting my own idea of what I wanted movies to look like. So that was the style that I brought and had been focused on fiction sort of up until that point. After this documentary, there's just a wealth of opportunity for storytelling and forming new relationships in Lewiston through the process of documentary making. So since then, that's really all I've done.
So did the tell us about how the making of the film changed the community that you were working with, and then separately, did the film itself wind up having the idea of using the clips that you were capturing of officials making statements that they weren't living up to. Obviously, there are ways of, you know, pushing that out there. But did the film as a whole help create change in addition to what you'll tell us it did for the community itself.
Yeah, I think the video camera and the process of recording and editing in this documentary, like I said, it was a tool in the process, and I don't think it should take credit for, you know, it was the group that really changed things. They did stop the road, but that was just the first year. The documentary covers many years after that, so they went on to do a lot more. But what the video allowed them to do was own their own story, because without that, there was basically, you know, the local newspaper or TV outlets, but they would sort of barely cover the issue. So I mean, a lot of it was just the issue is being omitted from a lot of media sources. But you basically had the story that the newspaper would tell, and then you'd have the story that the city officials would tell. It was very difficult for the folks to tell their own story. So video allowed them to do that, allowed them to do it very quickly when we put stuff on public access. And I think the final authoring of the documentary, which from beginning to end was a very, all of the people being documented were very active participants in the construction of that documentary itself. And in the sort of okaying of the final piece. But what they got to do was sort of write their version of history and legitimize their experience and the events that unfolded from their perspective so that this is the most sort of comprehensive academic piece on that whole issue and why it unfolded the way it did. And that's given the group a lot more legitimacy and political power, you know, in the city. And that was, when I describe the audiences that I make work for, first are the participants, who we often, you know, refer to as documentary subjects, but I think of them as participants in the project. So they're the first audience. Second audience is the people who have a stake in the immediate issues, so city officials or other residents in the community who will, you know, recognize the images and respond to it. They're the second group that I make the work for. And then more peripherally, folks that are interested in the topic of community organizing or urban redevelopment. And then lastly, the general audience. You know, I found a lot of general audiences do respond well to the movie, but that's sort of the last group that was in consideration when we made it.
When we come back to you, I'd like to sort of ask you a bit more about the legacy of the work and how that community has continued or how that group has continued their efforts on their own behalf. So, yeah, great. Thanks. Thank you. Hussein, can you talk to us a little bit about what it has meant to work under the circumstances that you've been in? You continue to live in Turkey, although I'm quite sure that you would have the opportunity, for example, to head to Germany or to France and find support there, but you're committed to remaining in your home country. And in circumstances that are challenging. So your film that's showing in the festival here is a fiction film, but you use quite a number of non-pro actors. And I think that also gives the film a certain feeling. And it's about, of course, you're working within that community as well.
I'm coming documentary background. I've done lots of documentary about human rights violation in Turkey.
Can you move the mic a little closer?
Yeah. Thanks. At the beginning, it was just only to record what's really happening, because in the 90s, we had a terrible internal war, 3 million internal refugees, 3,000 villages destroyed by the army, and many young people were in jail. Even I was in jail when I was 20, just because of joining one demonstration and stay 1 year in the jail. That time were very dangerous for the young people who was coming from worker class family or Kurdish family. There was not so many choice, so to go to mountain, join the guerrilla and fight, or stay in city and abused by state terror. That time I decided to shoot documentaries. I wanted to record what's really happening, because when you open the television, you never see. And it worked for a while, and then I wanted to continue with the fiction things too, because after the documentary stuff, I find out information doesn't change the person. Empathy changes the people. Sometimes you catch with documentary, sometimes with fiction. So, but mainly I always done my movies to my own people where I live. I mean, so if I want to change, first I want to change my neighbor. In this case, it was Turkish people because they were under attack of media from one side, and they never know about anything about Kurdish people and their life. So they only know us stereotypical way as a terrorist, as a smuggler or refugee, whatever. That's why I never complain about my situation, but I several times arrested with camera. But I always say, you know, if your people, your own people are under the dangers, you don't have right to complain. It's because mine wasn't more than their difficulties. So, but in a case also, I find out the camera is a kind of protection too. I mean, they don't want to do much to, if you use camera, maybe they are trying to stop you, but not more than that. Yes, I'm still doing documentaries and the fictions. I see a cinema totally in one tool to communicate with the others. It doesn't matter if it's documentary or fiction or animation. When the story comes, I just follow the story. But when you do fiction films, you need bigger amount of money. It takes much longer to finish it. Sometimes my stories can wait, like, you know, I can, because the last movie I spent 6 years to finish, and most part was looking for finance. But sometimes, also we show one short movie here. It was a collective movie, omnibus movie about Turkish prisons. That time there was a big hunger strike in the prisons because of the conditions. I remember we were 10 director. We just came together in a half of a year with all volunteer, you know, from the front of the camera and behind the camera, without any finance. We finished an omnibus movie about prisons, and it was a big effect in Turkey. More than 150,000 people watch, and still watching everywhere. So, depending on the project, we have different kind of difficulties, but generally.
Your prior film, the narrative film, Gitmek, My Marlon, My Brando, mm-hmm. You won the Best New Narrative Filmmaker Award at the Tribeca Film Festival, which is a very high accolade indeed. Did that make it any easier to finance this film?
I thought so, but it didn't. actually, I have to confess that I'm a little bit stubborn. I don't want to look at the I want to tell my own projects, own stories. I mean, as a talented director with this title, I could find some extra easy jobs. But I just wanted to do the last movie I done. And then it becomes, again, same kind of difficulties. This is a found system. They don't want to accept you directly. First, they want to, you know, make small changes to your story to fit the their agenda. But in the same time, it's good that they have, because at the end, if they really like it, like my project, they fund it, you know, they give the money, and then we have able to shoot. Yes, I can say. Let's see the third one. I'm now very curious. Yeah. Very famous Kurdish director said, on his biography, first film is important, but third one is more important. If you can continue or not, I hope I will.
Well, when we spoke yesterday, you talked about how important a sense of urgency can be in driving the work, and that sometimes it's possible to wait too long for the best circumstances in terms of funding and partnerships and so on. But when you really feel the importance of a topic, whatever it takes, moving heaven and earth to make sure that you can be there. It's partly, I think, as you and Alban discussed it, about bearing witness to something that might otherwise not be seen, but it also is about your heart and what you feel you have to do. So coming back to that, maybe you'll share with us a clip and talk a little bit about the film.
Okay, now we'll see the Come to My Voice, my last movie. It was a it's a storytelling of Kurds. Kurdish people has a oral culture. We don't have written culture as much as other nations because we don't have country. But that's because of that the storytellers are very important for the continuity of the culture. I wanted to use that form to show what exactly our situation right now in Turkey. I mean, we are living in a war situation and stupid decision taken by military members and innocent civilians having trouble with it. But I just wanted to combine with this storytelling way of Kurdish storytelling, and maybe we'll see a little bit this.
Neyse kalk.
Burada, burada yürü.
Bir kere de uğraştı böyle. Söyleyin nerede var silah burada?
Ben silah çöneyim. Şu silahı hemen çöneyim. Şu silahı ya.
Gel lan buraya. Uğraştan inle. Elle vurdun.
Bak bakalım bana 15 kere 20 tane de tabanca getireceksin. Duydun mu? Şimdi size son kez soruyorum. Silah var mı yok mu? Toplayın oğlum. Al.
Al. Al. Al. Al. Al. Al. Al. Al.
Bak, sen parasını ayarla, tamam? Ben de sana silah ayarlayayım. Yardım edelim, düşmüşe yardım edelim. Öyle değil mi ya?
Götür silahı.
Çıtı dönle, çıtı dönle.
Hala silahı
var. Hala ya.
Kostayım, kostayım. Tabii içe bir yakın, çok saygı.
Canım, dış dakika, hey polis et, hey. Bu arada ordumaya gelmelerdi.
Uff! Bu arada dengemem oğlum.
Absolutely beautiful. I'm so impressed by the actors, and in a way, the kids especially are really striking. Are they? Well, I'm going to assume, having read that two out of the three storytellers in the film are actual storytellers, and one of them is an actor. But the grandmother, for example, and the kids. What was it like sharing the film with them in particular?
First of all, maybe I will tell how I work with them, because you know when you go to an old lady to say that you will be in a movie, they don't directly jump. But these ladies are, as I told you, I'm coming from documentary background. When I were in writing stage, I was know that I will find those ladies because I know them on the real life. So it happens. It was the first lady I saw was her, and same for the kid. When I talked with the old lady, Kurdish lady, she said to me, "Don't worry, son. It's like my life. We will shoot it. Don't worry." You know. So she didn't even ask what was the script about. All when I just talked generally, she was part of it. And when she understood our motivation, why we are doing this movie, she was even never complained during the shooting. Same for the kids. So for me, it was amazing to have this process. And most of the scenes, she improvised all the dialogues, which was giving me more strong emotions, which I would never write with the best of scriptwriter. Also, some of the people already watch, they know what I mean. So it was great, and luckily we were in, we done our world premiere in Berlin Film Festival, and we went there with the little lady and old lady. For the little lady, it was first time to be in big theater. I mean, there no before that. They were so excited and so happy. But main reason for being happy, again, like Nick said, he's also he has a similar film like mine. People were happy because they show what really they had. Our biggest problem right now, we cannot hear other people's voice on the big media. So that's why I started making movies. So we were happy. We had also a chance to see a show in a real location with other villagers. They were so happy too.
So it's been screened in villages and community centers and so certainly the Kurdish population in Turkey is having an opportunity to see the film through these kinds of screenings, correct?
Yes, true, and we are still continuing. And this next month, it will be again very big tour, town to town, city to city, village to village. One Kurdish organization will take care of 10 movie and show the everywhere. But mainly for me, it's important to show this movie in Turkey, the west side, in the to Turkish people. I mean, because they need to see more of this because we are in a peace process, and they luckily everyone wants peace, it seems. So this kind of movies will help to encourage them. Luckily, I also got a best audience award in Istanbul Film Festival, which was very makes me very happy because it means Turkish audience got it and they supported, you know. So I'm optimistic person in long term. I believe the small change in our life will be big one day when the person find the right moment to remember those things. So these feelings help me to continue making films.
We look forward to seeing you here again next year.
I will. By the way, I mean, I'm very, very happy to be here with my family, 3 months old son. Somehow I pushed my family to come here before he was born. It's planned before. I want to thank all the festival people there, so friendly. And I'm really thinking now to make a new film to come back and come back and come back.
Excellent. You, a lifetime membership then. Yes. In the Myth family. That's great. Well, let's go on to Alban, whose shift and departure from the work that you were doing before also has a very strong personal connection, if I understand correctly, Memory Lane and its original development comes from that personal experience. So can you share with us how that drove you to begin that process from coming from the documentary world into this almost applied situation?
Yes, for the past 25 years, I've been working or involved in all sorts of documentary filmmaking, and with always a strong social impact in my work. My very first documentary was about the ethnic war in Burundi and Rwanda, and then I worked with Doctors Without Borders, and I always thought that my role as a filmmaker was to educate and to show things, not necessarily as an advocate, because we can't do it all, but just to show what was happening. And about 5 years ago, when my grandmother was affected by dementia and Alzheimer's, I decided to do something about it. So again, I'm not a physician, I'm not a doctor or a therapist, but I thought, well, there must be something that I can do to bring my domain of expertise and experience in filmmaking and in storytelling as an art, use the illusion of reality to bring memories to her. And I started to create a body of work. I don't need to remind, I'm sure, any of you the impact of dementia and Alzheimer's in the world. I mean, in this room, just to give you an idea, half of us will be affected by a form of dementia, whether it's Alzheimer's or Lewy body or vascular dementia, before our life ends. So we are all concerned about what you're about to see. And I thought we need some very simple tool to help us remind who we are, where we are in space, because when you will be slowly confined into solitary confinement, surrounded by gray walls during your whole day and living in stress and anxiety, you will not be able to follow plot-driven television. You will not be able to, and you will not remember, slowly you will remember people of your own family. And so when I realized that, I thought this is a very important topic, I need to address it. So I gathered award-winning filmmakers from all around the world, people of my entourage and therapists and geriatric physicians and prestigious organization, and we decided to do something about it, and we started to create this body of work that has now become Memory Lane TV and Memory Lane Therapeutics. And what we do, and you'll see in this very short 3-minute film, is we use, we combine two elements, guided imagery as the primary source of creating the illusion of reality in a very different format. You're going to see very small excerpts of the films that we are making, and it's a plot-free television. There is no narration, no voiceover. It's very straightforward, and normally the excerpts that you're going to see 5 or 10 seconds, just because we have a 3-minute slot, but normally they would last 3 minutes. And the sessions that are provided throughout the day, the therapeutic protocol calls for 2 or 3 sessions a day. We follow the circadian rhythm of the people in the institutions, and we offer different categories of sessions using archival images or nature sessions or musical sessions. We help them sing and reactivate their memory and stimulate their cognitive function. And I thought, you know, the illusion of reality, I'm sure Klaus will talk a little bit about that, is very important, because as filmmaker, as art creator, we recreate the illusion of reality. And to me, it was I couldn't understand why we could not do that for them, because it was a very captive audience, and we needed more than anyone else. They needed to dream. They needed to smile and come alive again. And so the 3-minute film that you're about to see just gives you a very wide spectrum of what we do, and I'll be happy to answer any questions about how it works and Memory Lane in general.
Thank you.
you share with us just briefly how you, what is the work behind getting information about its availability out in the world? Do you go to conferences? How do you make people aware that this is available?
Well, this is a very good question. And because as a film producer, I'm used to making films. I generally don't sit in panels. I'm more behind the camera, and making the awareness implies to have a strategy to communicate. So we use social media. We work in very close partnership with institutions in the medical world. We communicate about the work that we're doing through advocates that sometimes are the institutions, sometimes are the family members that talk about our work in general. But it is a very difficult and a challenge for us, because just like in any case, you know, we're trying to produce over 150 hours of content, so it's a very expensive endeavor, and just the production aspect of it. Producing the images, creating and working with the musicians, and you mentioned olfactory stimulation, so we used to work with two different companies, and we bring olfactory stimulations in the home of the patients and in the institutions, reproducing the scent of coffee and smell, and so this is only the production aspect of it, but communicating about it is also another big and very expensive endeavor. So. It is a challenge, and I'm still struggling with it. I've been working and dedicating the past 5 years of my life. So if anyone has any idea, please communicate about it. Share it with social media, and we need every one of us to talk about it.
Okay, I'd like to come back again to talk about, if we have time, the internet and different ways that people are using it. But I'd like to move on to Klaus, who comes to the making of this film from some very unusual background, in the sense that you've been trained as a director of photography. You have a lot of technology in your background, but you've also been a music impresario. And tell us a bit about what drove you to this topic, and now with so much of a really high-level festival exposure that you've had. You won the Fipreski Prize at Thessaloniki. For those of you who don't know, Fipreski is an international prize awarded by the International Film Critics Association, so it's a very meaningful award. You had a Cannes premiere, you've been in Vancouver and Toulouse, and the French critics have been very admiring of the film as well. So. How has that led to using the film in a social change environment, and what brought you to it in the first place?
Well, in fact, I have a technical background, but I always wanted to make fiction films, which I did, and I would never have been an activist for human rights, etc. But I mean, I live in Paris, and there are all those homeless people on the street, and you never hear them, you never know who these people are. Many people talk about homeless people, but nobody knows who they are. And so I was really curious. I went, and I've been telling my wife for years that I would like to spend some time just sitting in front of them and talking with them. And so that's how it came up, the idea of making a film, in fact, filming, spending time, yeah. And so we did the film. I spent my nights with the homeless people, just sitting in front of them, talking with them. And so I had no idea. I mean, it wasn't I had a scheme, you know, for, you know, saying I have to talk about it and to bring it to the media whatsoever. I just wanted to make a film. And so the good thing now is that, of course, the film got good reviews. Many people saw it in France. And so now I really hope it brings change. For me, the most important thing, in fact, we always, when we think about what can we do, what should be done, how can we communicate with the politics, the politicians, etc. I don't have much faith in politics and politicians, and I think that what really is important is that we all can do something, and that's the great thing. When I get responses from the film, from the audience, I know that people said, "Oh, it changed my point of view on homeless people," and now I talk to I start to talk with them on the street. That's the greatest reward, and I'm really touched by that afterwards. But it wasn't my idea in the first place. I did it for myself because I was curious and I wanted to discover something.
Well, share a clip with us, and then I have a question for you after that, if you can set it up for us.
Yeah, so it's a trailer.
Moi, je m'en suis sorti, j'ai monté ma cabane. Avant, c'était les tentes, c'était un carton comme ça. Ça, c'est des cabanes de fortune. Parce que le mètre carré dans le 7e arrondissement, il est cher. Ben, ça va, je paye pas.
Avant d'être ici, dans cette situation, j'étais chez moi, à la maison. Home. Avec mes enfants.
À chaque fois qu'il y a le marathon de Paris qui se court, moi, je cours le marathon de Paris. J'en ai marre à fond. En fait, quand on regarde bien, l'homme, il régresse. Il retourne dans son passé. Il avance pas, il recule. Il n'y a que la technologie qui suit les époques.
Une si belle neige, regarde.
L'important, c'est de jamais perdre de sourire. Toujours avec le sourire.
The film been exposed in France in particular? How is it reaching the public?
Well, of course, we were very fortunate because it went to Cannes, and this is always very good. And then it had theatrical release in France. I don't want to go into the details, but we unfortunately had a very bad experience with our distributor, who was in fact a crook. He lives in a fantastic house in a very, very rich suburb of Paris, and he took all the money from a homeless film. But except for that, I mean, the film did really well in the theaters, so it stayed, I think, 24 weeks, which is
wow.
Fantastic, because usually you can't, it's now we only stay 2 weeks in the theaters. The theaters where Terminator whatsoever runs, but it's an art house theaters. But we reached an audience of 70,000, I think, in the theaters, which for France is really good for a documentary. And so now the sad thing is that we have a hard time showing it in television, which would bring us a much broader audience. I think mainly for two reasons is that, first of all, thanks to the incredible courage of my producer, we started the film right away. We had this energy, we wanted to make the film. I pitched him the idea. I said, yeah, I want to make this film about the homeless people with no analysis, no commentary, just I want just their voice in the film, and I want each shot to be beautiful as a painting. And he said, oh, let's do it immediately. We start. And so we started right away. So we didn't finance it in the regular French circuit, you know, where you get grants from this, TV channels, finance. And then when you start a film like this, it's very hard to get back into the regular thing. And so the film hasn't been financed by TV channels. So first of all, they screen the films that they have financed. And also, we're in a world that tends to be formatted more and more. And this is not a typical documentary because I didn't try to explain. That's how you got on the street, how that, I just wanted to listen to people. So it's, the format is a little bit different. So, but, well, still we have, I mean, we hope it will run on TV, but in France we have something that we call the media chronology. So it was started in the theaters in January 2014, and that means that public television or non-pay television can show it only 2 or 3 years later. So it still can happen. So we.
And you mentioned that the film may be having some release in the educational market as well.
Yes, so in France, there's a commission every year that, so I hope we'll take in this. And I just recently learned that that the American University circuit somehow took the film. So I might be back at Colby to show it. I'd love to. But I have not more information than that, because I just recently learned it and I got an email. Oh, are you interested? I said, of course, that's wonderful. So I hope, because for me it's very important to show the film to, as I said, we are the ones who can make a change. And I think I have 4 children, and I know adults even, but also children, you know, the preconceived ideas we have, that's how you should wear this shirt, these shoes, etc. And of course, homeless people there, you know, we make fun of them, and it's terrible. And I try to educate my kids well, and sometimes they make fun about homeless. I say, you cannot do that. I mean, they are human beings. And so for me, it's very, very important to show the film to young audiences. And and I had some screenings with almost 200 ninth or 10th graders in France, and it was wonderful, because you see that sometimes they, you know, they don't dare to talk in front of in the theater with many people, and I had so usually the ones who talk first are the ones who are, you know, the macho guys that want to make a funny joke because they dare to speak, and question after question, you know, people open their hearts and it's such wonderful comments. And so I really think that it's important to show the film to young audiences and in the schools.
Certainly one one of the things that's had a big impact in public service broadcasting is, and this is true internationally, is that quite often films that have a campaign in mind, that have a real purpose and intent of change as an outcome, and whether it's about conservation or human trafficking or whatever. In Europe in particular, we're finding that these films are doing well in the cinema, but then public service broadcasting doesn't want to show them because they feel that they're too much of an advocacy piece, and it goes up against what is considered their policy and their standards and practices. And the heartbreak in that, of course, is that television does reach a lot of eyeballs, although, as we discussed last evening, in this day of the internet, that's not the only way to reach a lot of eyeballs, nor is that necessarily the most effective approach depending on your subject. You know, if using Craig's work as an example, your work, the first place of impact you want is local. So we're trying to find this balance. You know, how can you reach the most people, if that is a goal, while at the same time not offending or upsetting the gatekeepers, who then keep you away from those eyeballs that you want. And it's a challenge. I think Hussein's thought last evening when we were discussing this was, you know, basically, that to the gatekeepers, and we'll get the film out there no matter what. But tell me some of your thoughts about this, because we're not controlling the media. We are facing access, as much as we love the idea of the internet providing us a means.
Yeah.
How do we balance the need to maybe earn back some of our sweat equity in the project, or see the film actually have an income, up against the desire to make change happen?
Yeah, it's very hard, because it's shocking, as you said, that some, they say maybe it's too, yeah, there's too a strong will to tell something in the film, so it's not neutral enough. And we have a French national television which is privately owned, And in France, all the independent people were very happy because one sentence said by the head of this TV station came out, and it wasn't supposed to come out. And he said something like, "Our job is to sell to the to people who have commercials. You know, is to sell them free moments of human brain." I don't translate it well, but what he said is that all the programs they show, it's to make the audience mind ready to watch the Coke ad, you know, Coca-Cola ad. And so, of course, it was very shocking, but we were very happy that it came out because he said it. So, we cannot change anything. But you know, it's terrible when you think that when you make a film with a conviction, you know, and you can't get it in because it's not real enough, and then they, in fact, behind that, they only want to sell Coca-Cola. And it's getting stronger and stronger, and we have to find another way. I don't know, in the 19th century in France, the Impressionists, they said, we go out, we paint, or the Nouvelle Vague. You know, we have to invent something, because, yeah, of course, with the internet, we can show the film. It's important to, yeah, the net neutrality, all this stuff is important that we, but I have no answer. So
I just want to bounce on what Klaus says, because we need to create those mechanisms. And in France, we have the luxury and the fortune, since after World War II, to have the Centre National de la Cinématographie, French National Cinematography, and they fund and they help us fund projects that would not normally be funded. And I think, and they help you write the script, and they help you broadcast it. And this is huge. And this is why we still have a predominant in the world film industry in France, and are able to compete with Hollywood and others. And we've seen over the past few decades the disappearance of Italian filmmaking and British filmmaking and Spanish filmmaking, because they don't have those mechanisms. So one of the answers is, yes, we have to find, and foundations have to help filmmakers that have or want to make documentaries and filmmakings, and foundations have to help us, and a national organization have to create systems where funding is made available, so films that do not have a broad audience and are not made to sell Coca-Cola advertising can be produced.
I'd like to pursue a couple of things, but we have a room full of people here who have been very attentive, and they may have some questions for you about the work that you've been doing, or want some reflection on what their experiences have been up against yours. Is anyone in the audience keen to ask one of our panelists a question about their work or about what you've heard about today? Please.
Hey guys, I think my question for you, especially those of you who sort of dabbled in narrative and documentary, is if you see a subject that strikes you as something that you want to tell a greater story of for the purpose of trying to create change, and it's like an injustice that you feel connected to but you're not a part of, right? So it's like not your neighborhood, it's not like your culture, but you feel so tied to it. How do you tell that story, either narratively or a documentary, and like respect that group of people so that you're not in any way being exploitative or being perceived as like commercializing off of their situation, you know? Like, Klaus, I think your film is beautiful, and it never seems like you're trying to exploit those people, you're just telling those stories. So like, is there any way that you can sort of enunciate how you approach that kind of work and that type of topic?
I think the only answer is to be honest, you know? I made this film never thinking of a purpose. I don't think I'm better than these people. I don't think they're better than me. We're just human beings, and we listen to them. But it's true that, first of all, we have to know that my producer financed the film on his own, so we didn't make money. It cost him a lot of money, and the money that, I mean, it cost as much as a house, for example, you know, what he's put in the film. But it's true that we spent 1 year on the streets and filming, and it happened quite, not often, but it happened once in a while that people said, oh, you're exploiting them, et cetera. And I said, oh yeah, maybe it's better to ignore, you know? should I ignore them rather? And so my answer is just, yeah, be honest. I had never had the feeling that we exploited them. And then my producer, as I said, he spent a lot of money for the film, and immediately once the film was finished, usually the producers say, if they're generous, yes, when we get our money back, then we share the profit, you know. And he said, even if he was minus, I don't know how many thousand, hundreds of thousands, he said, the first euro we get, we start to share for homeless organizations. And that's a way to help everybody. And not only, and when the shooting ended, I said to each of the persons, now the film is over, what can I do for you? And most of them said, you listen to us. That's the most important thing. And so I don't want to say this to say, oh, we did something good. But again, to say, you all can do that, and that's the greatest gift you can give to everybody, in fact. We have to listen to our fellow human beings. I don't know if it answered your question, but,
Nick, can you share with us, coming in, here you are, a Swiss man in Barrow, Alaska, with a First Peoples nation. How did you make that step? How did you gain their confidence?
Yeah, first of all, I have to say, hearing the stories from my fellow filmmakers here, I feel a bit guilty, because I wasn't affected by I wasn't motivated by something that affected me personally. I was just curious to get to know people who are the exact, well, not the opposite, but something completely different, because I was just interested, like you said, Klaus, yourself, you're interested in the homeless. You weren't intending to make a film like an advocacy film. So it's a similar situation with me. But I think the fact that I was Swiss was, for them, it was so weird to them that somebody from such a different place would be interested in going there, because it's not a place where tourists necessarily go in Alaska. It's the northernmost town in Alaska, or in the US. And so when I got there, the young people who are the subjects of the film weren't so hesitant, but the older people, they didn't know. I mean, I got along with them right away, but the problem was there have been other people coming in and making news stories about, especially like the whaling, for example, and they didn't focus so much on the backstory or the history of the place. So to people who were just looking at these clips, it was just turning them off to see the whales being slaughtered and some of the other activities that people didn't get it. And the film, because it's a 90-minute film, it takes a long, you have enough time to get into this world and into the way of life that you understand. And this is what I was trying to explain to everybody in the place. And I think after a while, they were very open and talked about more personal things. And of course, as any other documentary filmmaker, you just have to be very patient and not be too pushy right away or ever. But you have just to take your time to get to know each other before you can really dive deep into some of the issues. So that's how I proceeded.
Craig, we can assume, as you wound up living in that community, as you shared with us in the clip, you did take a step outside the ivory tower of the Bates campus and now are part of the community that you made the film about.
In that case, it was at the invitation of the group of people to do it. You know, I didn't start recording until they said, you know, they were ready for that, and we didn't do anything with the footage until they said what they wanted to do. I think that the way that I approach it is, I think some of like the operative words in the work that I do are participation and accountability. I think accountability, I mean, I'm interested in political organizing, so obviously accountability, holding decision makers, people with power accountable for the power they have is really important. And I think motion pictures are a really powerful medium. And so the same questions come up. Who has the power to create the representations of truth that we consume and use as symbols and references when we're having conversations about society or about where we spend money or about how we treat people? When I do work, I mean, like I said, this was sort of the one that really got me thinking about this, but all the projects I've done since then are projects that are ones that the subjects, who again I refer to as participants, they can reach out and they can affect the project. And when even when it's done, you know, I'm still, you know, they are close enough to me, they're close enough to the project that I have to live with the consequences of how they're affected by that work. And in some ways I'm creating those channels, and in other cases it's just because I'm making work where the people are physically and geographically like close enough to me that you know, I'm going to feel the impact if it messes up their life in some way. So being really, I think entering the project, being really aware of relationships of power and who traditionally gets to represent stories and identity, and being conscious of how those traditions and those power relationships are going to play out through the project, and actually trying to develop mechanisms that are going to counteract what is often a very oppressive force. I mean, the history of documentary is not one of transformative social change in its entirety. You know, documentary was largely used initially by governments or like wealthy people to just collect stuff from around the world. You know, ethnographies that are just like, oh, that's like weird and bizarre and interesting, and if I like have that, if I can capture it and then like show it to people, then that's like cool because I've got something like interesting that other people haven't seen. So it's, you know, like travelogues and you know, colonialism, all that stuff, like that's all bound up in the history of documentary, and there have been moments where like documentary has broken through and actually done more like subversive stuff, but it definitely has a history in being an oppressive medium. So I think when someone is approaching a subject, particularly one that they're not invested in, or you know, they could make a documentary and then just walk away and not be affected by the impact of that work on the subject, they should be thinking about that stuff.
We have a couple of minutes. Anybody else wish to ask a question of one of our panelists? Yes?
Greg, you had mentioned the word accountability, and this is a question for all of you. How do you measure your accountability for your own work?
The response of the subject, you know, their assessment of how they felt about the project. I mean, before the public sees it, you know, they see it and they usually have an opportunity throughout to give input on where it's going. And another piece I guess I'll say about this is I think it's important, no matter how a movie's made, I think transparency is important in the final product. And as long as you're transparent, I think there's a lot of different options available to you in terms of how your work is made. So I don't think this is, personally, I don't think my process is problematic in the way that it's biased by the subject. Like a very traditional vein, I think, of documentary making would say the subject should not have any kind of editorial control. And I think it's okay so long as you're clear that that's the case and the audience can take that into account when they're seeing it. But I think the subjective, you know, experience of the participants, of the subjects, is the best measurement of how accountable the project was to them. I'll leave it at that.
I should say that since we got underway a little bit late in this room, and I know the museum now being open with people wanting to visit this gallery, unfortunately we have to wrap up a little shorter of time than we had originally planned. But I would encourage you to, the filmmakers will be in the lobby. If you would like to speak with them directly, please feel free to do so. I wish we had had a little bit more time to take some more questions, but we can do it one-on-one later. So for now, I just want to thank all of you. It's really been a pleasure to speak with you and learn more about your work and what you're doing. And thank you to the audience, and glad everyone could be here. So.
I want to do a announcement. I'm going to my movie. If anyone wants to see, it will start at 12:30, right?